And my time was running wild in dead-end streets. And every time I thought I got it made, it seemed the taste was not so sweet. So I turned myself to face me. I've never caught a glimpse of how the others must see the faker. I'm much too fast to take that test.
Changes.
Turn and face the strain.
Changes.
Don't wanna be a richer man.
This is Dr. Ed Park, and I'm recording part 8 of 9 lectures on exosomes. This lecture is entitled, What are the risks associated with exosomes? When we think about risks, certain things come to mind. One is financial risk. Second, quality control. Third, lack of potency. Fourth, safety. Fifth, untoward effects. Sixth, mixed blessings. And seventh, be careful what you wish for. In terms of quality control, as a result of being a product of human cells, the care to manufacturing is very, very important. The process involves, I assume, from scientific papers describing the isolation of exosomes, centrifugation, filtration, and the removal of unwanted tissue and solute components. Also involved with quality control would be monitoring of conditions of the growth and support medium. This would involve a constant surveillance of the media. Also, you need to check for the products of the exosomes. You need to analyze what proteins and what messenger RNA are actually being produced periodically. And again, these reports are provided by the company that I use, and assuming that they are doing their job correctly, then we have a fairly consistent and safe product. Part of that safety is, of course, infectious disease, and within the limits of PCR testing, there's a highly sensitive and highly specific way to rule out the major concerns regarding infection. Another aspect of quality control is maintaining the frozen chain of custody. Now, of course, financial risks. There's only one company making this product from MSC exosomes. A second company may be providing something of similar nature at a higher cost, but I have no experience with them. Because it is a de facto monopoly, there is no market competition per se. Therefore, the cost or markup includes disposables, physicians' fees, perceived value, supply and demand, of course, the overhead of office staff maintenance, and the risks inherent, which are difficult to quantify. Bottom line cost to the consumer is comparable or less than current stem cell autologous treatments, I would say. If the benefits are there, then it would be hard to quantify a risk and reward for something that is effective and yet much safer, I believe, than using donor stem cells. The risk of potency is one that's easily addressed. We rely on the manufacturer to produce a consistent product, ethically and reliably sourced. Luckily, it's easy to measure the quantity in milligrams and infer back the number of exosomes in billions based on three different versions of concentrations, the more concentrated ones being used for areas where a high volume would be difficult. Unlike cells, exosomes do not require preservatives or suspensions, and they don't lyse or explode like cells might if they are frozen, so they retain their potency after thawing. The composition is determined by the cell that's producing the song But since they are largely from the same individual, they tend to be very homogeneous, if not monoclonal. The potency should be consistent as long as you're measuring the end output of what's in the exosomes. But again, the potency will depend on the end organ action and what the client or patient receives. As the quote goes from Don Quixote, the proof of the pudding is in the eating. Of course, infectious disease screening is performed on the mesenchymal stem cells to rule out the possibility of things like HIV, hepatitis, and other infectious concerns. PCR screening is very sensitive and very specific, and after extraction, there would be no way of reintroducing these infectious pathogens. Mesenchymal stem cell exosomes, they do produce significant cellular signals. What effect that will have upon the cells is largely unknown, there could be some untoward effects. Luckily, the suspension, as I mentioned, is in normal saline. There's no suspension media or growth media. There's no DMSO or other preservatives to be of concern. If we're talking about stem cell exosomes from the MSC line, they, of course, don't have immune antigens on the surface, the major histocompatibility antigens that would be present in maybe exosomes from immune cells. So there isn't that risk of immune rejection or graft versus host disease. Of course, with an acellular product, there would be no way for the graft to even attack the host. The stem cell behavior is bacteriostatic and anti-inflammatory, so it follows that the exosomes from these stem cells would also be bacteriostatic, or slowing the bacterial growth and modulating or decreasing unwanted inflammation. In my clinical experience, there is some possibility of inflammation starting around day 3 and forward. And interestingly, it usually only lasts hours. It doesn't represent permanent damage in my experience, or anything that would persist longer than a day, which is interesting. Exosomes are probably trophic, meaning they, by virtue of blood flow to inflammatory sites, or maybe even other surface markers, go towards areas of inflammation, areas of pain, and indeed, somebody who is a chronic smoker, they could go to the lung and produce a transient bronchitis. Since most of the more damaging effects of aging and chronic disease are from inflammation and perhaps autoimmunity, the exosomes from mesenchymal stem cells should have a very high therapeutic index. They don't trigger any more inflammation, but rather they downregulate it. Of course, as with anything, you can have mixed blessings. What I mean is, for example, in my mother, her blood pressure dropped, so she needed to adjust the medications because she was waking up with too low a blood pressure and dizziness from that. Similarly, if the organ function or your pituitary feedback mechanism improves, you may need to reduce certain replacement hormones like sex hormones or thyroid hormones. Perhaps if the pancreas recovers some function, your insulin dose might need to be adjusted. So this requires careful consideration, and it requires a knowledge that this kind of thing could happen. If you're perimenopausal or postmenopausal, I suppose you could be at risk for resuming menstruation, ovulation, and even pregnancy. And as in the case with quite a few patients who have tried Recharge or TA65, the telomerase activator, sometimes this leads to a workup, meaning postmenopausal bleeding almost always buys you an endometrial biopsy from the doctor. There's the risk of lack of effects, but again, if they're kept frozen and they're from the source, I think that's a minimal concern. Almost everyone has felt something. Those reactions include some immediate euphoria in people, Other people experience drowsiness, and the drowsiness can come usually on the day of injection and at night, although occasionally a delayed sort of drowsiness can also take place days after. Again, there could be inflammation or changes in chronically inflamed sites such as the sinus or the lungs, hopefully towards a more positive resolution. And as I mentioned, a delayed transient inflammation lasting generally only hours can start on day 3 to 7, although some of my patients in their 80s or 70s can have delayed muscle cramps 10 days out, 2 weeks out, which again only generally is mild and lasts hours at a time. Very interesting. Finally, if you're doing an intranasal route, which is not common, you will expect to see hypothalamic changes, perhaps from cell remodeling or change in the system. This will manifest as thirst, decreased arousal, meaning drowsiness, or maybe even increased arousal, improved mood, increased sleep requirements, or decreased sleep requirements, lower blood pressure, change in sex hormones, a change in appetite. Again, the effects, as with all general adaptogens, will depend on how out of balance and which direction you are. So this requires a little bit of clinical expertise and some interpretation. When we talk about risk, we also have to be careful what we wish for. The saying goes, in this world, nothing is certain but death and taxes. So, interestingly, an upward spiral or improvement in your health may have you making life changes. You may start to exercise more, leading to a new injury, say of your Achilles. You may want to spend more money, and you may get dependent upon exosomes. A longer life will also mean longer taxes, but I guess in balance, that's probably a good thing. A longer life will also mean paying more taxes, but on balance, I suppose that is a good thing to be able to do. Now, finally, there are asymmetric risks. If you look back at your life, you have a 99% chance of getting older and sicker, given the fact that the FDA, as we discussed in the last lecture, is not about the business of curing humanity of aging. Their MO is about issuing intellectual property for small molecule drugs to mitigate disease. Some would argue to maintain disease. So your risk of getting old and sick is close to 100%. Your ability to regenerate, suppress autoimmunity, and control inflammation is a natural part of who you are and is augmented by having a lot of healthy, young mesenchymal stem cells. If you can't have them, then I suppose you could argue that having their byproducts of exosomes might also serve similar functions. If you want to learn more about this, I refer you back to lectures 2 and 3 about aging and parabiosis. Of course, most of us think and hope that lifestyle can help us, but in actuality, it only really mitigates, can only really slow it a bit. Most of what happens in aging is inevitable. You can certainly mess things up by having a horrible diet or mindset or breathing, but in general, lifestyle will not keep you young. I discuss ways in my book, The Telomere Miracle, published by Hay House, on ways that you can understand optimize these systems. But of course, we're kidding ourselves if we think that the system is not going to age if we're quote-unquote good. Using telomerase activators is something I do believe in. I've been doing for 11 years and have been seeing good results in my patients and in myself. A third part of the triumvirate of tools, including telomerase activators and these exosomes, would be senolytics. And of course, this is briefly touched upon in lecture 2. Senolysis is the ability to encourage old cells, which somehow have lost the ability to die, to die and clear the way for younger cells, we hope. I believe that the whole idea of MSC exosome therapy is based on a reasonable scientific conjecture. Because MSCs from this newborn placenta should be putting out signals of a young and growth regenerative nature, then they should be able to talk to your relatively older cells in a similar way and affect similar action, we hope. If you want to learn more about the clinical approach to using exosomes, then I encourage you to watch the final lecture titled Dr. Park's Approach to Exosomes. That'll be part 9 of 9. Thank you very much.